Good morning. Good morning. Welcome. My name is Michael Good. I'm an associate professor of history and a member of the Peace and Justice Studies program. I am very pleased to introduce Carl Stauffer. Carl Stauffer is the senior expert on reconciliation for the United States Institute of Peace. He is both a practitioner and an academic. His CV is very lengthy. He has 30 years of experience. He's worked in 37 countries. And before joining the United States Institute of Peace, Stauffer was an associate professor for the Center for Justice and Peacebuilding at Eastern Mennonite University. He was also the academic director of the Co-Scholars Program in Switzerland, the co-director of the Zaire Institute for Restorative Justice. He also spent 16 years in South Africa, working as the regional peace advisor for the South Africa region, the program director for the Africa Peacebuilding Institute, the education and training coordinator for the Letsema Conflict Transformation Program. And if that weren't enough, he also founded in Richmond, Virginia, the Capital Area Victim Offender Reconciliation Program. As a practitioner in peace building and reconciliation, Dr. Stauffer has done consulting work with a number of NGOs, including USAID, World Vision, ICRC. He has worked with governments, including the Ministry of Justice in Jamaica, the Community Development in Trinidad, and Safety and Security and Land Affairs in South Africa, and on. Seriously, I could spend 15 minutes going over all this. His key areas are transitional justice, including his critiques of transitional justice, trauma recovery and resilience, post-war reconciliation or reconstruction, restorative justice, peace building, and nonviolent social action. He has a bachelor's in social work and religious studies and a master's in conflict transformation from Eastern Mennonite University and a doctorate in conflict resolution and peace studies from the University of KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa. And without further ado, please welcome Dr. Carl Stauffer.
Michael did not do what I told him to do. And that was not go on and to make fun of me instead of giving that bio, that formal bio. It's really a pleasure to be with you. And am I going to do something wrong by taking this out and moving around? Okay. Just a real pleasure to be with you these 2 days, yesterday for the workshop and then this time together. And I'm looking forward to this session to engage. Hopefully I'll get out of the way soon enough for us to have some rich conversation. Thank you for having me here, for all those who have organized. This is a lot of work, and thank you for the time and the energy for making this happen. It's been a true joy. Let me just say a few things before I jump into the actual input. I did mention to the group that I was with yesterday in the work, I was born and raised in Vietnam. My parents were not with the military, they were with church, the Mennonite church, and in 57, when they thought there was an opening, by 1959, the U.S. was sending its first, what did they call them? Advisors, I believe, military advisors were coming in about 59. My parents decided to stay, and if any of you know Vietnam history, 1960 was the Tet Offensive. That's when the North Vietnamese actually penetrated the city of Saigon, where we lived. My parents refused to be evacuated on solidarity with the people that they were ministering and working with, and that meant that we took the risk, they took the risk with us as children, three children of being in the war. And the fighting came within a half mile of our home. We didn't know it at the time. We found out later, we knew it was close. The North Vietnamese had taken over a petrol station about a half mile from our home. And I remember, I have these memories, faint memories. I was 5 or 6 at the time, you know, of climbing under the bed, my mother reading and praying and singing and trying to keep us kids calm. My dad listening to the transistor radio, trying to figure out where the fighting was and where the curfews were and where we could be move or not move. And all of that to say, and empty bullet shells raining down on a tin corrugated roof as a helicopter was circling above us, raining fire down on this petrol station. Those are the memories that come to mind. And so those war memories are there. And they're part of what I do and why I do what I do and the passion that I feel about this work. And when I hear something like what Professor Minch just said, gave us, what an incredible tornado of evidence of where we're at. But it also gives me that passion and that drive to say we've got to continue to do this work. And if you, whatever you need to do to take care of yourself so that you're not a casualty in this, please do. Stay with us, stay in this process, because we're in it for the long haul. One of the most salient memories of Vietnam and being as a child, my father went out and took some photos after the Tet Offensive, took photos of burnt out tanks and various aspects of the damage that occurred. By the way, we got out of our home because a 13-year-old neighbor girl broke curfew, risked her life, and came over to our house and told us of a way to get out the back side of our house, and we all piled the scooter and made our way to another part of the city where there was less intense fighting. My father took a picture, back to the photos, that he would show when we would come back to the churches here, along with other photos, and it was a photo of a North Vietnamese soldier, dead soldier, feet tied together, and excuse me if this is a little graphic, I'll stop at that, being dragged behind a jeep, an army jeep through the Saigon. People lining the streets and jeering and throwing things. And I never knew why that stirred me so much as a child until I started studying peace building and realized, wow, that's the worst of humanity. The worst of humanity when we get to that place where we celebrate our victory on the desecration of the dead enemy. And so I think that became a image that has driven me in this work. I am going to not spend time telling you war stories. I'm going to try to move us into what I think are powerful processes of reconciliation, because that's where my passion is at. Let me say a few things about reconciliation before I jump in there so that I can maybe alleviate a few questions at the beginning. First of all, reconciliation, fully aware of that. I think because it's been used in very problematic ways. It's been used to talk about everything from governments of national unity to you and your colleagues getting along at the workplace to negotiation settlements to economic agreements to whatever. It's also enforced and used in religious and other enclave communities in ways that have been hurtful and harmful. And in its very linguistics has some problematics, and that is before anything in English means to go back to something that existed. So in fact, we had this big debate in South Africa, of course, during the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, like there is no conciliation. There is potentially conciliation, but we're not going back to anything that was good because the African community did not remember a good relationship with the white settler or the apartheid government. So I'm fully aware of these linguistic challenges and the problematics of reconciliation. I'm also aware that often the dominant culture, the oppressive culture, calls for reconciliation long before we're ready for it. Call for it because we feel like, it'll make us feel better. And sometimes we need to sit in the fire before we call for anything like reconciliation. Sometimes we need to do healing justice before we call for anything like reconciliation. Sometimes we need mass mobilization in nonviolent strategic action before we call for reconciliation. So on those notes, I'm still going to use the word reconciliation because it becomes this broad swath of research and study, and it means it's a deep concept if we're ready to sit in the fire of understanding what is this thing called reconciliation. So I'm calling the bit that I'm going to share today reconciliation, weaving social-political cohesion. Social cohesion is a term or terms that I like as an alternative to reconciliation. If reconciliation is giving you a lot of cognitive dissonance, I'd invite you to think about some other language that I'll use here. One of that would be social cohesion. But whatever the case, let me go into what I'm talking about, and maybe that'll help for us to try to justify a little bit more what we mean by reconciliation. First of all, we need to understand a spectrum of reconciliation. It's not we either have reconciliation or we don't have reconciliation. It's reconciliation at its minimum is the rejection of vengeance. The rejection of saying, I'm going to have to avenge, you know, through blood or whatever ways. And then it moves to tolerance. And tolerance has often been held up as sort of some sort of democratic ideal. But in fact, I hope we can get beyond tolerance. I'd like the people around me to more than tolerate me, ultimately. So then we move to the recognition of the other, that the other has the right to exist, has the right to have differing views and a differing worldview and different understandings of things. And I don't need to eliminate them in order to feel good about myself, or eliminate them in order to feel like I can, that safety involves me eliminating someone else from my life. And I use eliminating as broadly as taking their lives, which is often the case, but also separating ourselves or ostracizing or isolating ourselves from each other. And then there moves to the very thorny and messy part of apology and pardon. And I'm not just talking about interpersonal, though that's something we all probably have experienced or know about. Some of us had good experience, some have not. But I'm talking about also political apology and pardon. What does it mean for whole groups of people to take responsibility for violence and for conflict and for death and destruction? And then I would like to propose that there's a maximum improvement. There's a maximum improvement on this spectrum, and that is this idea that we have mutual justice and reconciliation in mind, mutual justice and collaboration in mind. And I very intentionally use justice and reconciliation, and I will throughout this brief talk use those together because I think they're inseparable. Actually, we need just reconciliation. We need to be reconciled justly. Reconciliation becomes thin and cheap if we do not wrestle with justice. Now, I'll talk a little bit more about what I think justice is. There are many ways to try to understand reconciliation at a collective level. There is the idea of vertical reconciliation and horizontal reconciliation. Horizontal being, of course, amongst us as people in a civil society or at a community level or whatever. Vertical being, what does it mean to reconcile with the state authorities, between the authorities and their citizens, the governance and their citizens. Very important levels at which we work. And then, of course, there's reconciliation of our past and reconciliation of our future. Now, what does reconciliation of the future mean? But an idea of, we don't really reconcile the future, but we grapple with the future and think about a future that involves, what we have to do in reconciliation is get to the point where we can imagine a future that all of us can be part of. Not imagine a future with only one narrative, not imagine a future where we all agree, but imagine a future that allows both of us to be in that future and to flourish. Dr. Eileen Boris talks about political forgiveness, and there's overlap in many ways to reconciliation here when she talks about the levels of work that need to be done. We're healing individuals, rebuilding communal relationships, and pursuing just political order. So I'm already stretching this thing of reconciliation and deepening it, I hope, as we begin this conversation. So my good friend, Dr. Professor Simon Keyes out of the Winchester University in the UK says there's really three major components to reconciliation. And that's in the black font here: acknowledging the past, some sort of acknowledgement of the past, new norms and relationships being developed, created, and this idea of constructing a just society. In other words, reconciliation has to be sustained in a container that allows it to be sustained. And that container is not some sort of ethereal peace. It is in a just society that reconciliation can be sustained. And so if we're after durable reconciliation, we have to grapple with justice. John Paul Lederach, and I'm mixing Dr. Simon Keyes and John Paul Lederach here a little bit, so bear with me, my little bit of creative license here. John Paul Lederach gave us three principles for peace building, which I've found to be really, really helpful, and he simplified them so I could remember them. Go backward in order to go forward. Go down in order to go up. Create more to have less. Let me talk a little bit about those. Going backward to go forward, this is really about this idea of we have to come to terms with history. We have to face our history. Just as if you were to go to get therapy or counseling, your counselor or therapist will most likely ask, what happened to bring you here? You can't really start therapy unless you go back and recall what's disturbing you. And collectives have to do the same. I remember when I was working with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, my son, who was at the time maybe between 5 and 7, that was between 94 and 97, was driving with his mother in the car, and he has always had a great imagination. He's an app designer for GoFundMe right now, so he's doing his ultimate job. But he was looking out and watching probably the traffic jams that we maneuvered through Johannesburg every day. And he said, Mommy, what would it be like if we could go backwards and forwards at the same time? I don't know what he was imagining, maybe a stretch limo or something going in two different directions. But when my wife came back after we laughed about it a little bit, I sat and thought about it and contemplated. And I said, this is what we're asking the South Africans to do right now. Go backwards and go forwards at the same time. And it's stretching. We're going back and dealing with this horrific violence of apartheid. And at the same time, we're saying, hey, guys, build a great democracy. Figure out what this great democracy is going to look like. I'm still astonished at how much condemnation South Africa gets for their frail democracy and how young it is and what they've overcome. But anyway, that's another conversation. So to go backward, to go forward, we wish we didn't have to do this work. I did my PhD work on Zimbabwe. And when President Mugabe, late President Mugabe, came to power in 1980, he came to power on a platform of reconciliation. Not only reconciliation, he said, we're going to change the name of this country, thank God, from Rhodesia, which meant nothing, in fact, meant oppression. Cecil Rhodes. Don't want to get into his colonial activity there. But in any case, let's leave it at that. So he changed it from Rhodesia to Zimbabwe, a powerful, prideful aspect of the development of that amazing civilization. And then he said, and as if he turned over a flip chart paper and there was a white piece of paper, he said, we're going to rewrite the history of Zimbabwe starting in 1980 onward. And we cheer them on because we want that to be the case, but it's not possible. History will come back and bite us in the backside. And we know that happened in Zimbabwe. As valiantly as they tried, the racial injustices of the past continued to rear their ugly head and still do today. So let me move forward. Well, a few more things on backwards and forwards. A good friend of mine who runs a ministry called Healing of Memories, it's Father Lapsley, he's an Anglican priest in South Africa, had both of his hands blown off, and one ear is deaf and one eye lost in a parcel bomb that was sent to him by the apartheid government when he was in hiding in Botswana. And yet he's become a leading figure in reconciliation and trauma and healing. And he was, during the TRC, I'll never forget when he was testifying, he said, "I'm finished with forgive and forget." Of course, he's a proponent of forgiveness, but he was making a point. He said, "It's time to remember. It's time to remember and to make right." And I've always stuck with that. Forgive and forget is another one of those idioms that I've dropped out of my vocabulary as much as possible. It's not in the Bible, first of all, if anyone thinks it is. And second of all, we can't biologically, trauma tells us, we can't biologically forget. And then third, it's dangerous. And too many people have said forgive and forget, and yet they're having trauma reoccurrences, flashbacks, intrusions, etc. And then we tell them, you haven't forgiven yet. As opposed to, let's work on the trauma that's going forward. So I think his actual words were, let's remember and repent. Forgive and forget needs to be replaced with remember and repent. Let's go to the new norms and new relationships. Go down to go up. John Paul Lederach really is referring here to digging into the roots, and all of us who've studied peace building know that conflict analysis is cornerstone to our work. Going deep, trying to figure out what are the roots, the root causes, absolutely critical. To not go into those roots is to cut the plant or the tree at the trunk and then hope you finish the problem. What we know, of course, if you have any sort of green thumb, is that the roots will grow and come up, and suddenly you've got little plants all around the stump you've cut. And the less we dig the stump out, we continue to fight this. Most unfortunately, a lot of our peace-building work or our peace conflict transformation work has settled for cutting branches, trimming and pruning and cutting and not getting to the roots. How do we get to the roots? Well, it takes a lot of hard work. It is through the conflict analysis, but then it's acting on that conflict analysis. And the many things that the speaker before me, Michael, said about what we need to do. But one thing about going down to go up, it speaks to me about two other things. It personally speaks to me about humility. We're in this work, we have to humble ourselves. And we have to expect other people to humble themselves in this process. Because in fact, there's a lot of interesting overlap between humility studies and this work. And I'm not talking about humiliation, don't get me wrong. There's a lot of studies about that too. And humiliation drives violence and drives conflict. I'm talking about humility, intentional humility, and what the profoundness of that means in this work. We have to be epistemologically humble, and we have to be very humble in the way in which we enter into a conflict. Lastly, create more to have less. We're moving towards this construction of a just society. This has two meanings in my mind, and I referred to it yesterday at the final panel. The one meaning is I think sometimes we have to stir things up in order to get to peace. And so that's where the nonviolent action comes in, and we're called troublemakers and rabble-rousers and all of that. And I'm like, well, that's, you know, so was Jesus. And I'm okay with that. Because I have a horizon of peace in mind. I think it was former President Mandela, who said he kept this horizon of reconciliation in mind for his 27 years.
prison, that's what got him to the place where when he came out, he had such a powerful message. So, but the other thing about create more to have less is that we have got to be master designers, master architects, to put together the infrastructure of this work of reconciliation and peace building. And it's going to take time and energy and a lot of hard work. But we must get to that task or it's going to be too late. The other thing I failed to mention at the beginning is we are on a, you know, we talk about democracy regressing, peace building is regressing too. The research that indicates how long peace agreements are lasting and how sustainable they are continues to regress. We're at a place where we're scrambling to do image control, okay? Or what is it? Or damage control. We're being told now that most peace agreements, peace talks, peace agreements across the globe are breaking apart, crumbling within 5 years in some form, in various forms. They're not holding. And why is that? There's many ways, and I'm gonna be very simplistic because I'm arguing for reconciliation. But I'm just going to put it forward. I think part of the problem is we like formulas. We like recipes. We like techniques. And we've gone off, our diplomats go off, and they do neat and tidy technical work. And then they close up their briefcase, and they pack their clothes, and they fly home, and they think the peace agreement is done. It's not. And relationships can never be shortcutted. We cannot pretend to do this work without stepping into the fire of the messy relationships that need to be mended and healed and brought together and put into dialogue and put into collaboration. And so we've lost this ancient piece in our work in peace building, and that is relationships. And I know that sounds simple, but I don't know how else to say it. We've got to get back. I dream of the day when our diplomats are taught what reconciliation processes look like, and it becomes central to the peace process. The peace process becomes the first step in what we consider rebuilding relationships. So let me take a little bit of those three principles coming from both Simon Keyes and John Paul Lederach and unpack them just briefly. One of my favorite parts of the preamble of the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission is it takes this time to define truth. And it says there's four kinds of truth. Forensic truth is the one we all know about. That's the facts. The so-and-so traveled to such and such a location, and these people were killed at this place at this time. And those very important truth. We need that truth. Our legal fraternity tells us that is the truth, but that's not the only truth. And they go on to say we have a personal truth that each one of us carries into the process, and that personal truth is our story. It's the story and the experience that each one of us brings and of the violence and of the conflict. And then there's this thing that we struggle with the most, and that is the collective narrative. This social political truth, it's ideological, it's cultural, it's religious, that is sort of the container for the violence or the propagation of it, or potentially in a positive way would help us out of the violence. But that social political truth is what we ideologically fight over. What's happening, as we heard, in our country here in an incredible way, coming to terms with that becomes one of the greatest challenges we have. But I think there's even a greater challenge, and that's this fourth one, the healing truth. And anyone want to do a doctoral dissertation on healing truth? That would be great. We have not researched what this is. So I'm talking about it right now from sort of, I'm sure there's great research out there that I haven't found, but I'm talking about it from experience. I think healing truth, if I may surmise to begin with, is all three of these truths. Giving privilege to all three of those truths, setting up systems and structures that give voice to all three of those truths, and realizing that we have to weave forensic, personal, and social political truths together and we have to come up with something that we know will involve a bit of give and take, there's going to be some compromise. But it's going to be a healing truth that says we can now live together and we can imagine our future together. On his experience of being, he wasn't tortured, but he was interrogated for hours and hours in the former Yugoslavia. And he talks about memory. And he has a book that's called The End of Memory, Remembering Rightly in a Violent World. I don't know if anyone has read that. It's a powerful book of interspersing his personal testimony with this reflections on memory. And he talks at one point about memory as a shield and memory as a sword. And it's a profound moment to think about this. In other words, the truth, the transitional justice field holds up memorialization as a powerful form of healing, and it is. I work in that area symbolically as well as materially. Memorialization is absolutely critical for the psyche of a collective or a community to work through these processes. But at the same time, Wolf is challenged and fighting with the bad memories, the memories, the traumatic memories, the memories that cut to his heart. He says memory can be a shield. It can help us with healing. We have to recall to heal. It can be a form of acknowledgement, which allows us to humble ourselves and take responsibility or someone else to. It can bring a great deal of solidarity when we share these memories together and hold on to them together. And we find comfort in the fact that others have experienced what we thought was our own isolation, our own pain. And memory as a shield can be protection. And when we can hold a memory as the you know, the classic Israeli Jewish call after the Holocaust, never again, hold that memory together to try to protect. But at the same time, the memory can be a sword. We've seen this over and over again. Memory can be distorted and disruptive, and it can cause division. We can pull out historical memory and then use it for political ends in the critical current present. We can use amnesia as a way of denying harms and silencing history. We can use memory for exclusion, to say these folks did this and that to us, therefore we cannot live in the same proximity, we cannot interact. Memory can be used as a weapon, can be weaponized and as a threat to all that we're working for. I remember a colleague of mine who was sitting in a meeting in Northern Ireland. And this was early on, and he was trying to acclimatize himself because he was from South Africa. This is Dr. Brandon Hamburg, by the way, Duncan, you know Brandon. And he had traveled from South Africa and was trying to find out the context and learn as much as he could and everything. And so he was in this meeting and he had read everything he could and he had known about the issues, he thought, and so on. And in this meeting, and I'm sorry, I don't remember the name, but a family name came up. And the emotion in the room rose to a level that it was palatable. It was like you could cut it. And all of a sudden, people were in this vicious emotional debate about this family. And one side said they're a traitor to the cause, and the other side said, no, they're heroes. And it was back and forth, and Brandon was lost in this, and he turned to his host and said, who is this family? What's going on? What is this name? And they said, oh, 100 years ago. And he's a psychologist by training. He's like, but the emotion in this room . So we have to deal with memory. How do we remember rightly in a violent world? I often talk about remembering without revenge. Let's move to new norms and relationships, to go down, to go up. John Paul Lederach also talks about the process of enemy formation. And I think we heard a good example of that in the speaker before me, but he talks about three S's to enemy formation. The first is separation. Second is superiority complex, and the third is subhumanization. And these three S's, some of them are rather benign. Separation seems a little bit benign at times. I separated my children when they were arguing too much. The question is, what do we do in separation? Separation in and of itself will not heal, and it will not bring rapprochement. So we have to design separation, and it's required maybe at times to keep people from killing each other and blood being shed. But how do we design that reconciliation process, that separation process in a way that begins to bend hearts and minds towards the work we want done? My wife and I do marriage counseling, and if a couple decides it's best we separate at this time, that's perfectly plausible and maybe important. But then we always say, in that separation, what is your separation plan? What work are you going to be doing on yourself, and what are you going to be doing together as a couple? How are you going to find the support you need, et cetera, et cetera? But separation, left unattended to, leads to superiority complex, because we can begin to talk about the other far, far away, with the different language and the different culture, but our culture is more superior, our language is more superior, etc. And when we get to that place of superiority complex unattended to, all sorts of justifications for subhumanization and the treatment of human beings in atrocity can be humanly justified, or supposedly. An example here in the United States coming to the table is a network of communities that started out of Eastern Mennonite University, where there was some students in the Center for Justice and Peace Building who were challenged to think about the way in which those ancestors of the enslaved Africans and the ancestors of those who enslaved people were interdependent in many ways. That was a hard challenge. And the ancestors on both sides in a local area often end up, and now with DNA, we know that actually, in fact, there can be shared biological connections. And that's been powerful imagery and powerful challenge. But this coming to the table is saying there's a way in which we can come together as the ancestors on both sides of this horrific structural oppression and violence and figure out what does it mean for our relationship to be a positive force in the current reality in this country. And so they have a four-part process to their model. Facing the past is the first. And they go into in-depth research to really document their family, genograms and so on, and figure out their family's relationships as well as the horrific parts of the past that they need to own. And then they take a bit of a rest. They pull back, because that's intense. And they build trust and relationship, not on all serious matters, on other kinds of matters, but they know that they have to build this relationship if they're going to stay in community. And interestingly enough, when they first started, they used to switch the building of the trust and relationship and start with collective healing processes, and they realized that it was too soon to go to healing right after facing the history. They had to step back, take a breath, and start building relationship in order to stay in that place. And then there was a moment when they could begin to say, okay, jointly we're ready to look at our traumas that we're all sharing and all carrying. And finally, they take joint action. And this can come in the form of many things. It's about publishing their experiencing. There's many books that have been coming out of this. It's about publishing historical knowledge of what they're learning in their research. It's also about doing things like putting up historical markers that are significant that have been neglected. And so that kind of joint action is the work that they're after, as well as racial justice work, etc. Thirdly, we want to look at this constructing a just society. There are many frameworks. One of the frameworks that's caught my imagination, in a positive way, I hope, is the transformative scenario planning. Adam Kahane and his team. This is a process that says looking to the future is one of the ways we can break impasse and deadlock. If we find ourselves stuck in these conflict-saturated narratives, if we find ourselves stuck in this sort of closed-loop thinking, which often happens in the conflict in the present, how do we get out of that? And this has been part of the peace-building world for a while. We used to always ask the question, what do you imagine your relationship to be in 5 to 10 years? If you have first of all, you have to agree that there's some interdependence, that you are going to have to be together in 5 to 10 years. Otherwise, there's no will or motivation for this. But if you do know that this relationship is going to go into the future one way or another, how do you want it? And the transformative scenario planning was sprung out of Adam Kahane, who was doing business scenario building in profit business. In fact, was working for Shell, but that came to an end for various reasons. And he was looking for something much more meaningful and transformative. And so he took the shell of that, excuse the pun, and I didn't mean that one. I wasn't even planning that one. And took the scenario and process and then turned it around to say, we're not building a scenario that's going to be predictive of the future so we can figure out how much money we're going to make or not make or how to be strategic in our business investment. We're going to build scenarios that have been designed by the people in the conflict who are going to sort of flesh out what could happen depending on how we decide to act and how we decide to be together. We could get here, we could get here, we could get here, we could get here. And they start with the idea of what are your greatest uncertainties about this conflict. So they're grabbing all these ideas that are really anxiety, ideas of anxiety, and saying, okay, how can we turn these anxieties into a future scenario that could possibly capture our imagination to the point where we would be willing to start acting into it? And so the conflict parties are brought together. There's a convening of the conflict parties in a really powerful and deep way. They have to stay together. It's a lot of dialogue and other process. And eventually they work through these uncertainties and they come up with a matrix which allows four scenarios to emerge. The matrix may look like something like maximum and minimum international involvement in the reconstruction of our country, and or maximum and minimum good or bad governance, or it could be, and then so it's based in reality. It's not just a dreaming of the best. It sometimes means that some of the scenarios are painful, and it's a realization that if we don't act in this way, we could end there. The status quo could stay the same. More people could just die, and we're still here, which is often the case. So in their process, this five process, they convene a team, they observe what is happening in the dynamics of the team. The team that they convene is usually national and spread and from multiple sectors. They don't have to be politicians. In fact, they encourage not too many politicians, and instead people who have sectoral influence, leaders of influence in their particular sectors and in the place that they find themselves in the society. And then they construct these stories of what could happen, and then they discover what can and must be done by the stories that emerge, and then they're challenged to think about how will we act to transform the system. Lastly, I want to present a little bit on restorative justice, which is an area that I have given my research and time to and writing to, and I feel very passionate about, but I want to use it in the sense of I believe restorative justice allows us to understand the bridge between justice and reconciliation. You might be thinking, how does justice and reconciliation come together? Well, it doesn't come together if the only definition of justice you have is our Western criminal legal system, which is configured on punishment as a form of changing people's behavior. Restorative justice says, no, justice, we have the same goals. Justice means we want to stop the occurrence of destruction and harm and violence, so the non-occurrence. It's just we have a different way of getting there. And instead of punishment, we emphasize accountability. We emphasize the fact that we can hold each other accountable in community in a way that doesn't necessarily involve punishment for the sake of punishment or pain for the sake of pain as a way to try to change folks' behavior. Restorative justice says, Archbishop Desmond Tutu used to always say it so wonderfully. Of course, most of you have heard of Ubuntu. It's been overused, and so I'm not going to play around with that one too much. It's actually a very profound cosmology. Archbishop Desmond Tutu, late Archbishop Desmond Tutu, used to say, "My humanity is all wrapped up in you. I cease to be human if I have no relationship with other human beings." And so restorative justice says this network, this social network, this capital, this social capital, this linking and bridging and bonding capital is absolutely critical in the process of justice. And justice needs to be taken away from legal codes alone and brought into human relationship, because ultimately human relationship is breached. That's what injustice feels like. And so what we have here is restorative justice asks a different set of questions. As I told my workshop, it asks a different set of questions, and those of us in academia know when you ask different questions, you get different answers. And so the questions that restorative justice asks, and there are many, but here are three of the main ones. The first is, what harm has occurred? And that might sound simple enough, but it's not. There's a very specific language chosen there. First of all, harm, not crime, because crime indicates some sort of legal abstract code. Harm refers to relationship. It can happen whether it's illegal or not. Second of all, harms allows an opening and takes us away from the labels of perpetrator, offender, victim, and says harm can happen across relationships. And sometimes we're both the harm doer and the harmed. In fact, most conflicts, if anyone's going to be honest, are complicated enough and complex enough that, especially in transitional justice, when we get down to truth commissions and stuff, this sort of claim to being the harmed only, the pure harmed or the pure harm doer, is impossible. And there's countries like Angola that said, we don't even want a truth commission because there's going to be no way we can sort out the harmed and the harm doers. We've all been harmed and we're all harm doers. So let's figure out how to get on with the future of our country. In any case, the second question is, what needs have resulted from these harms? Because harms are not isolated events. You don't see, this is the problem with crime as a code. You break a crime once at a particular time on a particular date. Harm says it's like a ripple effect when you drop a stone in the water. When I've committed a harm, there's a whole set of other implications, consequences resulting from it needs. A very simple example is if I break into Duncan's home and steal his property, that's the harm. The needs might be that he's planning to move out of his neighborhood. He's had to change all his locks. He's paying for counseling, and he doesn't feel safe in his neighborhood anymore, and maybe his kids don't even want to sleep in their bedroom anymore. They're afraid to go out. Those are the needs that have arisen from the harm. So you begin to see the impact, the shock impact in a society. And finally, whose obligation or responsibility then is it to repair or attempt to make right in some form or another, to some degree, these harms and needs? And that question is not only an interpersonal question. It's not asking only individual people. It's also institutional. Because we know that whole institutions can be the harm doer. And so we need to begin to bring that into the justice conversation. But there are some many guiding values in restorative justice, four that I find particularly meaningful, and these help me to see the overlap with restorative justice in my transitional justice work, and that is this idea of inclusion, first of all. First of all, we have to get past the idea of this victim offender and move into the idea that many people are affected by any conflict. and violence. And therefore, we need to bring as many of them around the table as possible. So inclusion becomes critical. Those affected by the conflict have voice in this process. Second of all, encounter. Not every restorative justice process ends up in people encountering each other face to face, but ultimately at the core of reconciliation is this idea that we will come together as human beings and talk and walk and move into the future in some form or another that keeps us from killing each other. Amends falls in that category of reparations, restitution, whatever you want to call it, symbolic and material. Most of our ancient cultures, if we go back far enough, basically referred to reconciliation as a very detailed network of amends, of reparations and restitution. You paid and you did certain things to show your remorse, and that covered the breach in the community. And once people saw and felt that, then there was a moment for them to move forward. Finally, reintegration. And that is the idea that, as I said about the humanity and how wrapped up we are with each other, that we're about rehumanizing and bringing folks back into the community. One of the joys of working in various conflict and post-conflict war to peace processes in various countries in Africa, and I'm not in any way insinuating that Africa has one cosmology, but there is a cosmology that comes in various locations that I've experienced that says no matter what you've done, you're still human. And you can't rehumanize yourself, but the community can help you rehumanize yourself. That's the integration problem. And when you come back into the community as a family member, as a legitimate part of this collective, that's our goal, and that's justice. I'm not going to chase you out. Keep you out. In fact, it's a strange concept to send someone away, because it's like we have the resources in this community, but we're going to have to fight in this country against the individualism of our culture that pulls us apart and isolates us and keeps us from thinking about how attached we are and how interdependent we are as human beings inhabiting this location called the United States of America. I'm going to stop now. Hopefully we can have some questions. Back of time. I don't know what time we have. Okay.
Thank you. One of the conflicts I think a lot of us have been following is the events in Ukraine, fighting in Ukraine. And I guess I'm wondering, first of all, I think a lot of the headlines here are very much focused on, rightfully so, on violence, on resistance, violent resistance in many cases, on shipments of arms, on high-level diplomacy. Do you know of any initiatives, maybe within some of these models that are happening alongside of those headlines we're seeing? And even if not specifically, maybe you have ideas about what would happen now or down the road in a conflict or post-conflict situation that could perhaps apply to that situation.
Thank you. It's really fresh to know exactly what's happening on the ground. I can talk about what happened before the invasion, or what's been happening, and there's certainly been some incredible work done in Ukraine particularly, not as much in Russia, but Ukraine, where there was a lot of dialogue process, a lot of effort at peace building, and some really significant work there, not to mention their nonviolence mobilization to change and sort of grab hold of their own future and so on like that. One of the things that's become a bottom line for me, whether I see it in the news or not, is to understand that the human resilience is incredible. I take an asset-based approach to this work, and I'm assuming, even in the most darkest and bleakest of conflicts, that there are people acting bravely and courageously to break the divides. And so what I say to students and others, go and look, who are the people intentionally moving across the divide to say, let's heal together, let's go through a trauma healing process together, let's dialogue, let's let's, in a very, it might be very small, it might be very local, it might be in a parish, it might be in a, but find those movements and connect them and coordinate them and give them voice, or not, you won't give them voice, but amplify the voice of what they're already doing. And if we can do that, I think that's the very, at least we should be doing in the start of this work. Russia, I don't know all the peace-building movement that has occurred in Russia. I did visit Russia and did some work with state mediators who work in schools and in the courts, and they wanted restorative justice training, but very specifically for those institutional elements at which they work in. And it was a fascinating time together. There's an association of mediators, which is about 35 different organizations in Russia doing this in a very small way. But I felt in much of the time there that they were speaking from a place of beleaguerment and sort of a sense of, we're barely hanging on. We know this is something powerful and important, and we're trying to find new ways to use it effectively. But it's a challenge within the institutions that they're working within. There are many folks that have been trying to do cross-border dialogue, and of course that's been broken in this current time, but we need to be calling for that to be built back up. And I don't think there's any time that reconciliation isn't important. And that's another challenge we have, because reconciliation has been pushed to the end as the last thing that can happen. If it happens, it's sort of like the cherry on top of the cake, and great. And I'm saying, no, we need to be thinking about reconciliation all the way through the conflict. In South Africa, during the CODESA negotiations for the new constitution, for the government of national unity, it was highly contentious time in the early 1990s. The civil society and religious actors were pulling people across all of the political divides into these encounter weekends in lodges all across the country. And they said, there's only two ground rules. When you come into this door, leave your political platform behind and come in being ready to tell your personal story and to listen to the personal story of the other people we've invited this weekend. And that's what they did. The whole weekend was a facilitated conversation of storytelling across these, of people across these political divides, but they had left their political platform. We now know that that played a critical role in keeping CODESA on track, because there was many walkouts and we heard of folks picking up the phone saying, hey, can you persuade your folks to come back to the table? Remember, we met at such and such a place on such and such a weekend, and for the sake of South Africa and for our future, let's do this together. And so that's one example of many of the power of doing this work, even in the midst violence. And so I'm sure there are many doing this. I wish I knew exactly who and what they were doing, and that I don't know enough right now to talk knowledgeable.
Thank you for the really fascinating presentation. I wondered if you could share your thoughts about ways that you've seen religion help or hinder efforts at reconciliation.
Thank you. A great question. And I come from a faith stance. My faith is really important to the work that I do. I'm a minister with the Mennonite Church. And so religion and faith have been critical to my journey. So thank you for that question. I'm not sure where I'll enter it. I think, you know, as we, there's two challenges here. One of the challenges is a movement which I find not very helpful, and that is to try to find the lowest common denominator to bring all religions together to have some conversation. Now, sometimes that's necessary just to keep violence, but I don't want to. And in my interfaith work, what I've heard the most is study your own tradition, know it well, and when we come together, let's talk from that depth. And there has to be a willingness to come together to first of all say, I'm coming to talk to understand. So that curiosity needs to be part of that process. And I'm coming to clarify, but not to change you, to convert you or anything like that. And that's basics for interreligious dialogue. I think religious leaders have been playing critical roles all through conflict resolution processes. They have been on both sides. They've been the propagators through messages that are sent from the pulpits or the stages or whatever in the worship centers all around the world. And at the same time, those who are walking with integrity and have begun to try to understand their tradition and their sacred texts in this way have found a way to become really important the third party mediators in this. And I've seen that in many places I've been. My own journey was to, after studying peace building, was to go back and read the scriptures, my sacred texts, the Judeo-Christian scriptures, through the lens of peace building. And some of you might be thinking, wow, I wonder how that went in the Old Testament. But honestly, I've come to the conclusion that there's an arch in this sacred passage that's about reconciliation. I don't want to sound cheesy, but it's been about God's efforts to reconcile with us. Us, God. And it shows all the messiness along the way. But there's incredible examples of nonviolence that Jesus must have been reading because this was his text. When he said, feed your enemies, he was probably referring to in Kings, where the prophet, they brought in the blind Armenian army into the king's court, and the king said, let me kill them all. And the prophet said, no, feed them. And they went home ashamed, and the raid stopped. So you begin to see that these threads are there, and how do we bring those out and make them relevant? So I spent quite a bit of time, aside from working within the political and civil society realms, with church leaders and across all sort of denominational persuasion, say, if you're going to live and preach this word, that's going to be political enough. Because they would always say, no, we can't get into politics. I say, don't get into politics. Don't mention any political party. Just talk about what the scripture, your sacred text says. Feed the poor, the orphans, and the widows, and you know, speak out when the ways of the government go against the ways of God. And you'll get in trouble. You'll already be an activist. Just do that. But it's a challenge. And I also fear that religion has been blamed for a lot. And we have to be careful with that because it's been a place of pain and trauma for many people. And so it's been blamed for conflict and the troubles of our world. And I think we only have to sit for a little while to know that many, many more people have died under non-religious regimes, governments, and ideologies than under. But how do we find that place of beginning to say, I believe all of the sacred texts have their places. I've seen Muslim scholars working on Quran, I've seen it in so many different scriptures and sacred texts that I think if all of us were beginning to do that, we'd begin to find a place to talk and then also act together without necessarily feeling the need to renounce anything that we believe deeply in, the traditions that we carry. I'm good friends with the pastor and the imam, if you've heard of that story. These are two Nigerian gentlemen, a pastor and an imam, who were on the alternate, were fighting each other. In fact, the pastor has a prosthesis hand that was probably blown off by one of the armed groups that the imam was commanding. And there was enough faith and hope amongst some people that they knew and trusted that they were brought together and eventually reconciled. And their video is out. It's called Imam and Pastor. And they now travel around the world working on peace building together. And they've suffered a great deal of rejection from their own communities and powerful processes that have been transformative because both of them are very, very devout in their different traditions. And James, the pastor, is a Pentecostal pastor. And the imam is from a long line of imams. And yet they have this office in Kaduna and in northern Nigeria. As I said, they have an incredible ministry of peace building, if you will, all around the world. We need more of those stories. think the gentleman here, and then I'm happy.
My name is Corey Armistead. Thank you for being here and presenting. I just had a quick question. So I wondered if with anything where we get to reconciliation, it almost seems like there has to be restoration too. I think you even used the word repentance at one point, which is feeling sorrow. A lot of times, I know maybe it's not the clinical definition, you know, because it's religious, but right. I feel like a lot of times it has to do with making right with that person, right. And it has to make them whole at some point. Obviously, if it's somebody who's been murdered or something, it's hard to do something like that. But in the vein of that question, the question I'm about to ask, I don't know if you're familiar with when Einstein and Tagore met, Tagore being a philosopher, talked about human truth, and Einstein argued about universal truth, where we, as a human experience, we only can perceive what we have done or anything happens only because we're humans, and that can ultimately only be truth. Whereas Einstein argued there is a universal truth, and that is outside of even what human truth is. So do you think that we will ever get to the point where we have technology where, you know, even in like law studies, they plug an algorithm into AI based off cases and how it will go or won't. And if things by way of restoration to like people in the past, and also talking about moving forward, going forward, if there will ever be a meeting point of technology, religion, to where we can create algorithms and ultimately get to the best possible solution, or how do you see essentially humans progressing in where you're talking about?
Thank you for that question. Fascinating. I'd have to take that one home and think on it for a while, but let me respond to a few things. Universal truth is a challenge, and it's a contentious issue, of course. From my religious tradition, there are, for me, certain things that are truth, big T truth, that I hold to. But I'm also aware that it doesn't have to be big T truth and small T truth. You don't have to choose between them. In other words, big T truth is made up of a whole bunch of small T truths that we bring into that equation. And so I don't see those. I'm able to do the end. That, you know, I don't feel like we need to have that conversation about universal truth with only one big monolithic T. We need to begin to think about there is universal. Each of us can claim a universal truth of sorts. I think we should strip that down to the bare necessities, and then we need to figure out how do our small T truths support or build that up or tear that down or whatever, and think about what we want to go from there. Second of all, I don't know a lot about this. The algorithms of computers that have been applied in, at least in the criminal legal system, have been fairly controversial because of the implicit bias that seems to continue to come out even in those. And so this continual challenge of how much can we rely on artificial intelligence in our ethics and integrity becomes hugely important in this conversation. And so I'm not quite ready to embrace this idea that there'll be some kind of technological future that will allow us all to come to some sort of universal bliss. I think we're going to be continually challenged as we are with our own human relationships in relationship to the technical world. It's going to be this love and hate relationship for some time. Where that leads us, I don't know. You know. So those would be two of my responses, and I'm happy to talk a little bit more about particularly the sentencing algorithms and how those have been proven, or there is some research coming out, it's contested, that those have at times left a bias in sentencing for various reasons that are more than I'm going to get into now. Yeah. Either one.
I was going to ask about truth, I guess, so
yeah.
It can follow up. The different approaches to truth that you provided in the
yes.
context of TRC, I do want to ask a question that has kind of two parts.
Sure.
The first part is about, I guess, what truth adds to that picture necessarily.
Yeah.
Like, why is it beneficial instead of just talking about facts, experiences, and ideological frameworks, like instead of talking about that, why does the, or why truth necessarily, or what kind of things that it might add to that picture, which I think, I would assume that it would become important for the healing truth. And so that's kind of my first part of the question. Second part is I can see a certain relationship between the first three in the sense that like facts kind of become meaningful for experiences and experiences become meaningful in ideological frameworks, right? Or they gain their meaning through social political frameworks. So I can see that kind of encompassing relationship between the first three, which makes me think, and you asked this question about the healing truth. So I'm just thinking, then what does that mean for the fourth part? And I just want to hear a little bit more about what you think about that. Thank
Wonderful. Thank you for that question, absolutely. That's a great question about the language, why truth is necessary to add on to those. I guess, and I'm gonna be talking now off the top of my head as I'm thinking about this, because I haven't given that in-depth thought, but truth carries with it an emotional ingredient, I think, a sort of sense of like, it's a holistic sort of sense of emotional and whole experience of the whole body and the embodiment. Truth carries a certain moral weight and integrity that probably captures the actual experience that folks have had in trauma and violence in a way that that the other ones would sound more technical and sort of, you know, like political bureaucratic jargon. And I think that's why truth has been so contested, why we have these things like the right to truth. And we've given truth this huge place since World War II in our processes of transitional justice and so on. And it's really important. But I think also, as I've taught about truth, truth doesn't heal. Truth in and of itself, it's not intrinsically reconciliatory or healing. In fact, it can be quite damaging. As we talked about memory, truth can be quite harsh, it can be quite harmful. And so we have to talk about truth for what means, for what purpose. And that's where the healing part comes in. And healing is, again, maybe not as profound a word, maybe we could find another word, but it's that sense that there is a profound meaning when a collective decides we are together going to walk into, lean into a future that we're making, that is leading us away from the past that was so destructive. And that, so there's something about that compact, that social contract that's profound, I think, beyond maybe what just healing infers. But I think healing is the best way, meaningful way to try to grab hold of that, which keeps that emotional and embodied presence in it. I think of Dr. Fania Davis, who is one of the leading experts in restorative justice and calling for a truth and reconciliation process in this country. And she was a 25-year civil rights prosecutor, attorney. She, by her own admission, says an angry one, and she burned herself out. She went off and got a PhD in indigenous healing processes, came back, couldn't find a job, went back into law to pay the bills, and found out about restorative justice. And she said, for the first time in my life, she was an activist, and now she had this restorative justice, which she was trying to come to terms with in all of the challenge that it has for the communities of color in this country. And she said, for the first time, restorative justice gave me the permission to bring my warrior and my healer self together. And restorative justice isn't perfect, it's not a panacea, but that's a powerful way of talking about this thing that we're after. Maybe one more, or we need to close down. Yeah. Luis, please.
It won't be quick, I'm afraid, but you don't have to actually answer it. I don't know if there's really like a complete answer, but very simply, like, it's always a treat, Carl. Thank you for your presentation and having like a colleague present and someone who's done work outside of the U.S. context. Now, asking your question more looking into within the U.S. context, domestic, public, national space, I'm curious how you would deal with the question of involving those people and groups that have been canceled in reconciliation work,
which in some ways it's asking what's your definition of cancellation according to like the current zeitgeist. What is the adequacy of you know of that term? In what way there's wisdom and there's some limits? And also, how would you deal with it considering, you know, your experience? Again, I know we don't have that much time, but I just wanted to drop it just in case.
Sure.
For fun.
Sure. So I think for fun. The first thing I would say is that while I was given a mandate to draw from what are we learning internationally, so I do think that what we're talking about here, while it comes from very different contexts than our own, whether we talk about Rwanda or whatever, these learnings that are coming out of those are absolutely critical for what we're experiencing now in this country, and we can't assume an exceptionalism in that. But we do have a specific context, obviously, that we're working out of that makes this very unique. Cancel culture. You know, I mean, if you go back to enemy formation, it's just a popularized form of that. It's sort of a pop enemy formation thing, because it basically says, first of all, I don't need to be near you. I don't need to connect with you. But second of all, we move to the second S, superiority. You know, somehow my beliefs are valid, yours are not, therefore I'm not going to listen or interact with you. And as we know, the next S is the most dangerous, which is what Michael was telling us right before. The next one is this sense of beginning to dehumanize to the point where we're able to kill for the sake of our ideas. And so we have a real challenge with that. And cancellation, as you full well know, is happening on both sides. On all sides, we're canceling each other. It's also an outgrowth of social media. When we can do inhumane things, we can scream and shout at people that we would never do in their face and then run away. We do the hit and run violence. And that's the kind of thing that allows for this kind of interaction, which is so dehumanizing, I think. And how to get into that? I mean, I think there's some folks that I know doing some really incredible work just right, literally walking, wading into that online and trying to start conversations with trolls, for instance, and literally. And then says, they shout for a while, possibly, usually, and then it says, can we go offline? If they've hooked them on something, they say, can we go offline? Can we take this offline? And they move offline, and then they continue the conversation. They've had some success in bringing the temperature down to even actually have a conversation that has some substance and also some persuasive substance. And I wish there was a lot more people doing that. I think we'd have to think about scaling that type of thing up in a critical mass way that would begin to address that. But that's only on a very individualistic level. I think anytime we begin to look at policy and legislation that begins to, as complicated and dignified and legally it's written, supposedly, but it's actually enforcing that kind of cancellation, that's where we need to begin to, the red flags need to come, and we need to begin to be working diligently and watching closely how we begin to legislate this kind of activity. And it's starting to happen. We see it in multiple ways. I'm particularly concerned about, teachers being told you can't teach a subject that's going to make one of your students uncomfortable. Well, then we've lost our educational enterprise.
Thank you, Carl. We'll reconvene at 1:00. Again, I'll remind you, if you want to grab a lunch.